Why is Dr. Hannibal Lecter in Silence of the Lambs so terrifying? At first glance, that question seems silly. He's a murderer who eats people. However, his unnerving presence goes much deeper than what we see on the surface. Compared to other horror film antagonists, one would think that Lecter would fall short. Horror icons usually have supernatural abilities or otherworldly powers. Freddy stalks the dreamscape, Jason and Michael Myers seemingly teleport and are unkillable, and Chucky is a literal doll possessed with the soul of a serial killer. These villains are an ever-looming threat and kill their victims with ease. In contrast, Dr. Lecter is just a man. He has no supernatural abilities, and he's already captured before his introduction. However, when I think back on my first viewing of the movie, I remember being uncomfortable whenever Lecter was on screen. Dr. Lecter's devilish presence and demeanor are nothing short of hair-raising. The fact that he was already captured and wasn't an immediate threat made no difference. So, how does a regular man, who's already locked up, manage to be so scary? Specifically when the film's narrative is built in a unique way compared to other thrillers. Most of us have heard the phrase, show don't tell, in reference to how to write an engaging story. But prior to Dr. Lecter's introduction, we see a different approach. The movie's protagonist, Clarice Starling, is an FBI trainee assigned to interview Hannibal Lecter. At first, she is instructed to persuade Lecter to fill out a simple questionnaire, but her superior's hidden goal is to gain information on an active serial killer dubbed Buffalo Bill. Her superior, Jack Crawford, advises her to be very careful with Hannibal, that he's not someone you want inside of your head. In the very next scene, Dr. Chilton, who is the head of the asylum that Lecter currently resides, refers to him as a monster and pure psychopath. He speaks of Lecter in a way that is dehumanized, even going so far that he's their most prized asset. Afterwards, Dr. Chilton briefly discusses the murders of Dr. Lecter and details specific rules on how Clarice should interact with them. He then shows her a picture of a nurse who Lecter attacked previously. He goes into gory details of the incident, saying,
"The doctors managed to reset her jaw, more or less, save one of her eyes. His pulse never got above 85, even when he ate her tongue."
This disturbing exposition, tied with Clarice's reaction as she sees the picture, causes the audience to brace for the gruesome image. However, the reveal never comes. Rather than having flashbacks showing Lecter's crimes, we are simply told by other characters what to expect. This gives the viewer a chance to build up expectations, ideas on what kind of evil awaits Clarice down in its cell. With our preconceived notions built, Clarice makes her way down the cell block past the other inmates. Before Clarice reaches Lecter's cell at the end of the hallway, her attention is directed to his neighboring inmate, Multiple Miggs. Miggs is clearly deranged. He bounces around his cell and verbally abuses Clarice. Composing herself, she continues forward and arrives at Lecter's cell, whose contrast to Miggs is surprisingly drastic. He stands politely in a well-lit cell, waiting for his visitor and even greets her with a pleasant good morning. While the differences between Miggs and Lecter's demeanor is obvious, the details of their surroundings are subtle statements as well. First off, Lecter's cell is well-lit in comparison to the other inmates. Clarice's visit takes place in the middle of the day, so this must be the standard lighting for the cells. It's clear that the orderlies and Dr. Chilton need to see all of Hannibal's actions at any given time. Second, Dr. Lecter is the only inmate without traditional bars. He's in a specialized cell which has small holes to breathe through and a sliding food carrier used to pass things back and forth. Even if you did make the mistake of stepping too close, there's no way for Hannibal to grab or pull anyone into his cell. The only way I could imagine him being able to do harm is by pulling on the food carrier while someone's hand was inside of it. This would result in a broken hand or wrist, but that's a lot better than him eating your tongue. However, if you got too close to Multiple Miggs, he could easily grab you and pull on your arm. Yet Dr. Chilton and the orderlies don't even mention him while discussing warnings and procedures with Clarice. Obviously, this doesn't make Miggs any less of a potential threat, but rather that the danger he displays is explicit, shown through his savage actions. Hannibal's danger is implicit, shown through his surroundings. Hannibal is physically cut off from Clarice, but that doesn't bring any comfort to her or the audience. Even with the room being well lit, and even with Dr. Lecter safely locked away, Anthony Hopkins delivers an impressive, unnerving performance. His acting prowess is only strengthened by the director's shot composition. Dr. Lecter takes up nearly the entire screen, his piercing blue eyes looking directly into the camera. Despite our knowledge of him being behind a barrier, we can practically feel him breathing down our necks. I can only imagine sitting in theaters as Anthony Hopkins' unsettling presence took up the whole screen. I envision audience members shifting and squirming uncomfortably in their seats as Lecter refuses to break eye contact. Dr. Lecter spends his time poking and prodding at Clarice, trying to glean information from her and searching for an ulterior motive. At times, he's kind and courteous. Otherwise, he's sharp and condescending. He toys with her much like a cat would with a mouse. Dr. Lecter is refined, patient, and cunning. When Jack Crawford's original intentions are finally revealed to Lecter, he subtly gives hints or pieces of information towards Clarice's goal of gaining information on Buffalo Bill. If he outright gave her the answers or refused to speak at all, she would leave and never return. Dr. Lecter is eventually offered a deal. If he assists with the capture of Buffalo Bill before his next victim, he will be moved to a different hospital in which he will have a nice view. He also would be granted 1 week out of each year to visit an island where he can swim and be on the sand for up to an hour each day under SWAT team surveillance. As enticing as this is to Lecter, he makes one more demand. In return for information that he gives, he wants personal information about Clarice. Although Jack Crawford warned Clarice not to let Hannibal get inside of her head, she agrees for the sake of catching the killer at large. This is where Lecter is at his most dangerous. He uses his knowledge of Buffalo Bill as leverage to pull Clarice deeper and deeper into his mind games. Dr. Lecter enjoys holding all the cards, forcing people to bend to his will, and uses his intelligence and understanding of psychology to get his way. Once he has someone in the palm of his hand, he's able to easily manipulate them and/or hunt them as prey. Whether he gets into an individual's mind metaphorically through influence or literally by, well, eating their brains, Dr. Lecter is in control. In the case of Clarice Starling, Lecter obviously has a unique fascination with her. This fascination seems to be a mixture between mere boredom, admiration for her keen intellect, and sexual attraction. However, this ambiguous adoration doesn't relieve any suspenseful tension between the two. Just because the psychopathic monster is sometimes nice to Clarice doesn't mean that he's somehow less threatening. If anything, his fondness of her is the opposite of comforting. Clarice, whether assured by the fact that Dr. Lecter was imprisoned or under the pressure of stopping Buffalo Bill from killing again, gives in to his questions. Unfortunately, Dr. Lecter's captivity doesn't last forever. Dr. Lecter was confined to this specific cell for 8 years. It's mentioned in the book that Dr. Lecter was a compliant gentleman when he first arrived at the asylum. In fact, he was so courteous and obedient that the staff were fairly relaxed around him, which led to him being able to viciously attack that nurse. He bade his time, gave them a false sense of security, and struck at the opportune moment. Of course, after that incident, security measures were increased, but Lecter remained patient and vigilant. Before moving to a new facility, opportunity arose in the form of Dr. Chilton's incompetence as he left a pen behind in Lecter's cell. After all of the increased security measures, it only takes one slip-up for Hannibal to gain the upper hand. In a new facility with new guards, Hannibal would find a chance of escape. During mealtime, two guards handcuff him behind his back to the cell bars and enter into his cell to set down his food. This is a massive difference between how meals were served to him through the sliding door and is ultimately Lecter's window of opportunity. He uses a part of the pen he stole from Dr. Chilton to pick the lock of his handcuffs, even stalling the guards for time by asking them not to put food on his drawings. Revealing himself now free, he attacks the two guards, relishing in their torment, and eventually kills them both. What is shown during the attacks is unsettling, however, the aftermath is much more disturbing and memorable. He hangs up and disembowels the corpse of one of the guards and removes the face of the other and wears it as a mask in order to escape. While these things are done off-screen, they are still absolutely shocking. Up until this point, we had only been told of Hannibal's lethality. The audience's initial expectations were subverted due to the cordial pleasantness of Dr. Lecter. However, not unlike the orderlies and officers who let their guard down to Lecter's charm and well-mannered behavior, the audience is caught off guard by his level of brutality. Dr. Lecter murders multiple people and breaks free from captivity, not due to otherworldly powers, but simply because Dr. Chilton misplaced a pin. With Dr. Lecter loose in the world once more, he takes a backseat in the narrative while the story of Buffalo Bill ends. Clarice finds Buffalo Bill, confronts him, and kills him in self-defense before he is able to claim another victim. For a moment, the audience can breathe a sigh of relief. Clarice is commended and celebrated for her work and bravery in stopping Buffalo Bill, but in the middle of her triumphant success, she receives a phone call. Dr. Lecter congratulates her on her success as well, before revealing that he's already back to his old ways. We see him stalking Dr. Chilton while saying his goodbyes to Clarice. While he pursues Dr. Chilton at a leisurely distance, the credits begin to roll. Dr. Lecter is only able to freely roam and kill again due to the incompetence of Dr. Chilton. Chilton's many flaws may have audiences tempted to relish in the fact that Dr. Hannibal Lecter will get his revenge on him. However, is that true poetic justice, or have we just fallen to the charms of Lecter's masterful manipulation? In the current day and age, most horror movies employ jump scares to frighten the audience. I hate jump scares. While I do think they can be done well, I think they have become a major crutch in the genre. Honestly, you could throw anything on the screen randomly with a typical loud audio cue and I would probably reactively flinch. It's usually cheap, unearned, and lacks nuance. The terror associated with Dr. Hannibal Lecter is built over time using tension and suspense. While he doesn't have supernatural abilities, his sharp mind combined with his merciless brutality make him extremely dangerous. The more that is revealed about Dr. Hannibal Lecter, either through dialogue or action, the more we are convinced that we are looking directly into the eyes of evil itself. If you're wanting more spooky stuff, then check out my video on the best shows to watch for this Halloween season, or feel free to check out my other character analysis videos here. I'll be doing more spooky stuff all October, so check back for more. As always, I hope you have a wonderful day, and peace out.